Wow, that was pretty cool. That was pretty cool, man. What a great time. I love you guys down here. I saw my face somewhere down there. That was a very awkward moment right there. So I was just looking in the face of beauty. It was amazing. So no, but seriously, you guys, I am so unbelievably thankful to be with you guys here tonight. This has been so awesome. Just sitting over here, singing with you guys, being part of this, watching you walk in. What a cool experience, and what a blast it is for us to be together like we are here. And I know, like Jeff said, momentum is so special, but I think really in so many ways, it's extra special this year. Having the past year that we've had and not having a chance to do momentum like we typically have, that's just made this all the better for us to be able to be together like this. And so it's so special. If it's your first time at Momentum, I know that you've already been welcomed by Jordan and the guys, but I just want to say welcome. We're so glad. Can we just give it up for everyone who's here for the first time? Just welcome into Momentum. We are so pumped that you're here. I hope that you discover that Momentum truly is a life-changing experience. I hope that you find that. And I can just tell you, there's many of us who have found that to be the case, and myself included. And so Momentum has been unbelievably impactful in my own life personally for a lot of different reasons, but I can tell you that there's at least two specific reasons that this has been a life-altering conference for me. And so the first reason is because this is actually the place, Momentum is the place, where my journey with Jesus Christ began. And so I actually had the privilege of being able to speak at Momentum a couple years ago, and if you happen to be there, you might remember I got to share a little bit of my story. And for me, I actually was invited to come to Momentum just before my 17th birthday. I was not a follower of Jesus. I didn't really grow up in the church. And so someone invited me to come. And when I came to Momentum, that was the first time that I had heard the gospel of Jesus Christ presented. And so I gave my life to Jesus at Momentum when I was a teenager. And my life, I mean, literally the whole trajectory of my life changed because of this conference. And so I'm so thankful for what God did in my life at Momentum. I'm praying that God might be doing something like that for some of you who are here. And the second reason that Momentum's been really impactful to me, and this reason's not nearly as good as the first one, is because Momentum also was the place where I lost my big toenails. And so I said my big toenails. And so to this day, quick weird fact about me, I don't have any big toenails on my feet. It's kind of nasty. The reason I don't have any big toenails is actually because of Momentum. And so back when I was a teenager, we used to do these service projects that we called Blitz Days. I think you guys still do those and those kind of things. And so I went to this Blitz Day, and we had this job of carrying these big boulders from one place to the other. I think they ran out of jobs, so they're like, just move that stack of boulders. And so I was carrying this boulder, and without getting too into the story, I dropped it on my feet, on both of them, lost my toenails, and they never really come back since. Or I should say, they haven't come back much. And so my toenails are pretty nasty. That might be too much information for some of you. But if you're interested and you want to come find me later, I'd be happy to show you if you want to see them. I will tell you, they kind of look like chicken nuggets. That's sort of what they look like. It's a little bit like that. And I actually took a picture. That's normal, right? You guys want to see a picture real fast? All right, here you go. Right here. There it is, it's my toenail. That's it. No, actually, that's a legit chicken nugget. And chances are good after this, you probably will never eat chicken nuggets ever again. And so that's good. But so Momentum's a place that I found Jesus. It's the place that I lost my toenails. And I'm really hoping that it is an impactful experience for you. But here's the thing, and I know you guys know this. Jordan was just talking about this a minute ago. You guys know that there are a lot of people right now who are praying for our time together. And so for the next 36 hours that we get a chance to share this experience, there's parents, there's leaders. I can tell you that all of the Momentum team, the pastors here, have been praying for you. And I just tell you that I also am one of those people. I have been praying for you, for each and every single one of you who are here and in the other locations that we're going to as well. Because here's what I believe with every fiber of my being. And this is actually the reason that I'm here, the entire reason that I'm here, is because I believe with every fiber in my being, that the God of the universe, the God who created all things, that he actually wants to communicate to you. I believe that. I believe that there's stuff, I'm not just like saying that, because I'm a pastor, I really believe that. That the God who created you, that there's certain things he wants to say to you. There's some certain things he wants to speak to you over the course of our time together. If you would be willing to listen, if you would be willing to open your heart, if you'd be willing to drop your guard, I believe that there's things that God wants to say to you. And here's what I also believe. I believe that there's some stuff that God wants to do in you. I believe that there's some work that he wants to accomplish in you. And so maybe for you, there's some stuff that God wants to encourage you in. Maybe there's some stuff that God wants to challenge you about. Maybe for some of you, honestly, there's some obstacles that exist in your life right now that are keeping you from running for God full bore. And listen, I don't know what those are, but maybe even for you right now, some of you know what those obstacles might be. And I believe that if you're willing to, that God wants to get a hold of those things. He wants to get your attention and he wants to do work in you. And here's what I also believe. I believe that God doesn't just want to speak to you and he doesn't just want to do something in you. I believe that as a result of the next 36 hours, there is some unique things that God wants to do through you. I believe that there's things that God wants to do through you in your school and in your family. If you're willing to allow him to do that work, I believe he wants to do that. And so because I believe that with all my heart, and I don't know your story, I don't know how you got here, but because I believe that God brought you here for that reason, I actually want to invite you, before we even jump in, would you just pray with me? Let's just talk to this God. And what I want to do is I actually want to allow you, I want to give you the opportunity right now in the quietness of your own heart. Would you just take a moment and would you just talk to God? Would you ask him to search your heart? And would you ask him to open you up and be willing to hear from him? So you take a moment and you talk to God. Well, Father, you're here, and we're here, and we want to hear from you. And so we ask as we open your word that you would open our ears, allow us to receive what you want to tell us. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, the theme for this conference, like Jeff was saying, the theme of the next 36 hours is the call. And as we start to think about this together, I actually want to invite you, if you would, why don't you grab your Bible with me? And I would absolutely love it if every single one of you could turn with me to Luke chapter 15, okay? So if you could humor me, I would love it if every single person had your Bible open in front of you, and if you would go with me in God's word to Luke chapter 15. And as you're finding Luke 15, and as we start thinking about this idea of the call, I want to ask you a question as you're locating that in your Bibles. And this is a question that you don't need to answer out loud. You can just kind of think about this kind of in your own mind. But I want you to think about this. What is the most valuable item that you have ever misplaced or lost? All right, so as you're turning to Luke 15, I want you to think about that. What's the most valuable item that you have ever misplaced or you have ever lost? And so here's my guess. The reason I ask that question is because I think all of us have probably had that experience where we have misplaced or we have lost something that's been valuable to us. We all know what that's like. And so maybe for you, you might think about a time that you misplaced or lost your cell phone. You might think of a time that you lost your car keys, or maybe you lost a piece of jewelry that was really valuable to you. I think all of us have had that experience. And I can tell you, I have had that experience for sure, but nothing compares to the time that I misplaced my daughter. That's right, I said my daughter. And just a little bit about me. My wife and I, we have four little kids at home, like Eric was just talking about. So we got four little kids, and we have three boys, and then we have one little girl. And so our little girl's name is Gracie. She's kind of our princess. Right now, Gracie's 5 years old. But the first time she got lost, and really I should say, the only time she ever got lost, was actually when she was three. And so here's how the story kind of goes. So my family was on vacation. So it was my wife and I and our four kids. And then we were vacationing with some friends who also had three kids. And so if you can imagine the scenario, there was two groups of parents, and then we had seven kids that were all 10 years old and younger. And so it was chaotic and it was crazy and it was like herding cats and all that kind of thing. And so I remember one night we decided that what we were gonna do is we're gonna go out to dinner. And so we said, let's go into town and let's walk to this restaurant and we'll go to dinner. So we went to town and we're walking down the street. And it was actually a really busy street. It was super congested and there was cars going up and down the road. And as we were walking, you know, we're trying to sort of wrangle the kids to the restaurant. And so we finally get to the restaurant and we walk in and we start to get everyone seated in the restaurant at their seats. And my wife looks at me and she says to me, she says, hey, babe. Because that's what my wife calls me. And I said yes. And she said, where's Gracie? And I said, oh, she's right. And I looked down and she wasn't there. And I said, well, I thought that maybe you had her. And she said, no. She said, I thought that you had her. And I thought, okay. So at first I thought, no big deal. You know, this happens sometimes. I wasn't too upset. I just thought, well, Gracie's probably up somewhere in the restaurant. Maybe she went to the bathroom or she went to someone else's table. So I thought, I'll go check. So I said, I'll just go check it out. So I got up and they stayed at the table and I started to look around and I tried to find Gracie in the restaurant and I went to different tables and I asked, like, have you seen a little girl? And she wasn't in the restaurant. And so now I started to get a little bit scared. And so I remember I walked back to the table where my family was and I said, you guys, I said, Gracie's not here. I said, and so we're not eating right now. We need everyone to get up. I said, we gotta spread out. I said, we have to find Gracie. And so we all went outside of the restaurant and we started to spread out. Some of us went one way, some of us went the other. And we started to go around and ask, you know, if anyone has seen Gracie. We started to call her out by her name. And after about a minute of searching, a minute or so, it became apparent that she was lost, that she wasn't there. And I gotta tell you that at that moment, I really genuinely started to freak out. And this honestly may have been the most frightened I've ever been in my life. And I don't know if you've ever been in a situation like that, but if you ever have been, just being very honest with you, it's really, really challenging to not let your mind go to the worst possible case scenario. And so I just started to look around and I thought to myself, man, my daughter's three and there's these cars that are going up and down the street. I thought there's all these people. I don't know who these people are. They're all strangers. There was a lake that was just pretty, my daughter's three. And so my mind starts going to these really, really dark places and I'm trying to keep it out. But I'll just be honest with you, I started to freak out. And so as I'm walking and I'm looking for my daughter and I'm asking if people have seen her or calling her name, my walking starts to turn into a jog, which starts to turn into a run. And as I'm running, my asking starts to turn into yelling and I'm getting frantic. And so now I'm going around and I'm saying, I'm going, Gracie, Gracie. And like I said, I couldn't control myself. And now I'm just yelling. I'm going, Gracie, Gracie, where? And I'm asking people, I'm saying, hey, have you seen my daughter? I can't find her. And people are staring at me, and I don't care. In fact, when people were staring at me, I remember I would just try to recruit them. I said, you gotta help me. I can't find my daughter. She's 3 years old. You gotta help me. And I'm running around. Well, anyway, long story short, 15 minutes later, which honestly might as well have been eternity. It was the worst 15 minutes of my life. 15 minutes later, this security guard drives past me in a golf cart. And I see him drive past me, and so I flag him down. I said, hey, I said, you have to stop. I said, you have to call the police. You have to call all your security buddies or whatever. I said, my daughter, I can't find her, and we got to find her right now. And the security guard looked at me, and he said, hold on a minute. He said, how old is your daughter? And I said, she's three. And he said, ah. He said, I have good news for you. He said, we found her. She's at the security office. And I was like, oh, I was like, man. I said, thank God. I said, thank God. I said, you got to take her to me right now. And so I got in the security car with him and we started to drive up. And I remember on the way up to the security office, I asked him, I said, hey, I said, where was she? I said, where was she? He said, it's kind of crazy. He said, she was actually in the store that was right next to the restaurant that you were at. And so apparently what had happened, we found out a little bit later, was that Gracie had just kind of followed a group of people that she thought was her family. She thought was us into the store. She's like, I guess you're my family now. And she just walked into this store And then when she realized it wasn't us, she just started to cry. And so the security guard, thank God, the security guard saw her crying. And so he went up to her and he said, and this is what he told me. He said, I got to tell you about this. He said, I went up to her and I said to her, I said, what's the matter? And she said, I can't find my mommy and daddy. And she was crying. And I said, well, what's your name? And she said, security guard said to me, he said, well, she told me that her name is Gracie. And then I said, okay, Gracie. I said, well, what's your mommy's name? And she said, my mommy's name is Jessica. So that's my wife's name. And then he said, okay, so what's your daddy's name? This is what my daughter said. She said, my daddy's name is Babe. And so my three-year-old daughter thought my name was Babe because that's what my wife calls me. So this security guard, this guy was awesome. This security guard looked at me and he goes, so you must be Babe. And I said, yep, Babe with no toenails. And I said, you gotta take me. So he took me to the office, and when we got there, I saw Gracie. Man, when I saw her, I just lost it, man. And I was so relieved, and I was so happy. And I went up, and she was just bawling. And I went up, and I just squeezed her so hard, and I just said, I'm just so glad you're okay. And you know what's crazy is, in that moment, Gracie actually thought that I was mad at her. She thought that she was in trouble. She had done something wrong. And I remember I told her, I said, oh no, I'm just so glad you're okay. I'm just so happy that you're safe. And so I called my wife and the rest of our friends, and we all kind of came together, and everything ended up being all right. Now, why do I tell you that story? Why do I tell you that? Now here's why I tell you that entire story, is because after that happened, I remember not too long after that, I was reading this very passage that we're going to be reading tonight. And it occurred to me in this moment that I think it's impossible for us. I think it's absolutely impossible for any of us to understand God, to understand his heart, and to understand his call. I think it's absolutely impossible for us to understand God apart from this one very important reality. And that's this, that our Heavenly Father is on an all-out search mission that is motivated by love. This is what I discovered when I read the Bible, and when I had this experience with Gracie, is it illuminated something to me about the heart of God that I see in Scripture, and that's this, that our Heavenly Father, listen, you have a Father in heaven. And he is on an all-out search mission. Not was, is, currently, now, on an all-out search mission. And it's motivated by love. I think it's impossible to understand God's heart. I think it's impossible to understand his call apart from this reality right here. I think this is exactly what Jesus' point was in Luke chapter 15. In fact, let me just show you together. Luke 15. Let's just look together at verse 1 and see what Jesus says. So this is what the scriptures tell us. The Bible says, now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear Jesus. Okay, so let me just pause there for a minute. And I really want you to try to do this with me. All right, I want you to try to imagine this scene that we're about to watch transpire here. All right, so here's what's going on so far. This is Luke chapter 15. So let me kind of just, you know, abbreviate what happened in the previous chapters. So Jesus, of course, is, you know, teaching and preaching and performing miracles. And he's going around. And as he's doing this, the Bible tells us that he is gaining a pretty strong following. So there's these large crowds that are starting to gather around Jesus. And the Bible is going to tell us that these crowds that would have come around Jesus would have been comprised of very different people groups. So there's all kinds of mixed people who were there to listen to Jesus. One of the groups that was there, I want you to notice, was a group of people called the tax collectors and the sinners. Now, I know there's a good amount of you who are probably somewhat familiar with the Bible. And so if that's you, let me just ask you real quick, by show of thumbs up, thumbs down, the tax collectors and sinners, were these guys viewed positively or were they viewed negatively by society? Yeah, big thumbs down, all right? Turn to your neighbor, say big thumbs down, all right? They were viewed negatively. These guys were viewed very negatively. They were considered the outcasts. These guys were considered, they were especially looked down upon by the religious community. And so that was one segment of people who were gathering around to listen to Jesus. Now, there was another portion of people that were present as well. And the Bible's going to tell us it was these guys. It was the Pharisees and the teachers of the law. Again, thumbs up, thumbs down. How were these guys viewed in society? Yeah, very positively. All right, these guys were the religious elites. These guys were like the varsity level church goer kind of person-ish thing, you know, whatever the title would have been. That would have been these guys. And the Bible tells us that these guys, now notice this, they were muttering. So you have this crowd that's listening to Jesus, a very diverse crowd. One side is muttering. And what are they complaining? What are they muttering about? Well, the Bible says they were muttering because Jesus was welcoming the tax collectors and sinners. He was welcoming them and he was allowing them to be part of his community that was there. So Jesus knows this is going on. Jesus knows that there's a tension in the room. He knows that one group of people is muttering against another. And so Jesus decides that he's gonna address it. But I want you to notice how he does this, because I think the way that Jesus does this is totally, unbelievably brilliant. And so how does Jesus address this tension? Well, he decides that this is a perfect opportunity for him to tell a story, to tell a story. And so the Bible is going to tell us that Jesus told them this parable. And what's interesting is what we're going to see is Jesus is not just going to tell one parable. He's actually going to go on to tell three parables in a row. It's like three rapid fire parables that we're going to see right in a row. Now, these parables that we're about to read, that Jesus is about to tell, these are all somewhat famous. So my guess is you've probably even heard some of these parables before, but I want you to notice what Jesus is doing. All right, so watch this. Jesus goes to his first parable, and here's what he says. He says, suppose one of you has 100 sheep, and then he loses one of them. And Jesus says this. He says, doesn't he leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? All right, so Jesus starts off with this first hypothetical story, this first parable. And the first parable is actually a very famous parable. A lot of you guys have probably heard of this one before. It's the parable of the lost sheep. And so Jesus imagines a scenario where there's a shepherd who has 100 sheep and he loses one and he leaves the 99 to go after the one. Now, here's what I want you to understand. So Jesus was talking to a first century audience, and to a first century audience, shepherding would have been a very, very, very normal job. And so it was very common. The people understood shepherding. They understood how it worked, unlike today. So I don't know about you, but I personally, I don't know anybody who is a shepherd. I don't understand anything about shepherding. I've never even met a shepherd in my entire life, so I don't really get it. And I know for me, when I read that the Bible says that he leaves the 99 to go after the one, to me, quite honestly, that seems very irresponsible. When I read that, I think to myself, why would you do that? Why would you leave 99 sheep who are in a vulnerable place to go after one? That just doesn't seem like a good equation. But here's what I want you to understand, is that apparently this was actually a very normal thing that shepherds would do. So from what I understand about shepherding, what I've learned, which is very, 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 very little, I guess that sheep are the most safe when they are together. So sheep apparently are followers. And so when you get them together and you put them in a field together in a pasture, that is when they're the most safe. It's when a sheep is wandering by itself. It's when a sheep wanders off and it's away from the other sheep that it's in the most danger, because then a sheep is most inclined to get lost. Then a sheep is most inclined to be injured or to be attacked by a predator. I thought this was kind of crazy. I was reading one article. So I told you, I don't really know anything about shepherding. But I was reading this one article, and it was from a Middle Eastern shepherd. And he was talking about the defense mechanisms of sheep. It's a very fascinating read. I would encourage you to read it. Not at all, ever. And here's what he said. I thought this was so cool. He said that sheep really don't have any defense mechanisms. And so he said, whenever they find themselves in a situation where they feel threatened, or they feel like they're overwhelmed, or there's something that's threatening them, he says, do you know what they do? Here's their defense mechanism. Sheep will, get this, this is what they do. They will, when they feel overwhelmed and attacked, they will lie down, and then get this, and die. They just die. He said they become so despondent, and they become so overwhelmed with the situation that they're just like, I give up on life. And they just lay down and they just die, as we said. So here's the point. Sheep are hopeless and sheep are helpless, especially when they're by themselves and especially when they're apart from the shepherd. And so Jesus makes this point. And what does Jesus say? He says, well, what the shepherd is going to do. Now notice the language. Jesus says he's going to leave the 99. He's going to go after the lost sheep, and he's going to look until when? Until he finds it. And then look what he says. He says, and when he finds it, finally. Now look at this. This is crazy. He says, he joyfully, isn't that interesting? Not angrily, not annoyed, not irritatedly, not begrudgedly, not you stupid sheep, tonight we're having lamb chops. In his joy, the Bible says, he's so happy that he found it. He takes it back, and what does he do? He calls all his neighbors. He says, you guys, we gotta have I found my sheep party. Come over, rejoice with me, because what's lost has been found. Now, what is all this language talking about? Do you hear this? What is Jesus talking about? Well, this is the language of an all-out search mission that is motivated by joy, that's motivated by love. That's what we see here. And then Jesus drops his point. Here's his conclusion. He says, I tell you, in the same way, there's going to be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who do not need to repent. So here's what Jesus says. He says, this is what my Father is like. This is what heaven is like. This is what my heart is like. And you can't understand me, and you can't understand my call apart from this reality. And my guess is at that point, like many of us who are here today, we think to ourselves, good story, Jesus. That's really awesome. That's a fantastic point. You have made your point brilliantly through your story. But then Jesus says, not yet. I have another story for you. And Jesus goes on to tell a second parable. Here he goes. He says this. He says, or, I got one more for you, he says, or suppose that there's a woman and she has 10 silver coins and then she loses one. She loses one. So first parable was the parable of the lost sheep. This is the parable of the lost coin. So the Bible envisions a scenario where there's a woman, apparently she has 10 silver coins, and then she loses one of them. Now again, to you and I, this seems really weird that a woman has 10 coins and she loses one of them. But let me kind of help you out with this one a little bit. So back in this society, in this culture, when Jesus says silver coin, he would have had a very specific kind of coin in mind. The word that's used there is actually where we get the word drachma from. And a drachma was equivalent to one day's worth of wages. And so it wasn't like a quarter. This was like a very, very significant sum of money. What's even more interesting, I thought this was kind of cool. Commentators point out that when Jesus says that there was a woman who had 10 silver coins, that it's very likely that what he was envisioning was that this was probably a wedding dowry. A wedding, do you guys know what a wedding dowry is? So in our society, when a young man falls in love and wants to marry a young woman, he will, what will he do? He will do very stupid things, but then one of the other things he'll do is he will eventually run somewhere into a jewelry store, he will spend a lot of money, and he will come back with a box, and he will get on one knee, and he will open that box in front of this woman that he wants to marry him, and what is in that box? Tell me. An engagement ring, right? Well, that's not how it worked back in this culture. So back in this culture, if a young man wanted to marry a young woman, what he would do is he would actually take his money and he would run not to her, but to her father. And he basically would say, I want to marry your daughter. Here's a down payment. And he would basically say, not exactly like that, but he would say, I want to marry your daughter and here is a dowry. Now, here's what I thought was cool. Back in this culture, it was very normal for women in their excitement to take that wedding dowry, and for the duration of their engagement, they would wear it like a piece of jewelry. They'd make a piece of jewelry out of it. It was like an engagement ring. And so because of that, when the Bible says that she loses one of these, I think what the point is that this is very precious to her. This is very valuable to her. And so what does she do? Look at the language. What does she do? She lights a lamp, the Bible says. She doesn't stop there. She sweeps the house. She searches, say it with me, she searches what? Carefully until she finds it. And then when she finds it, she calls her friends and she says, we gotta have I found my coin party. Everyone come over, we gotta rejoice because what was lost is found. What is the language? Do you notice? The language is, again, this is an all out search mission that is motivated by joy, that is motivated by love. And then Jesus drops his point. Here's his conclusion. In the same way, I tell you, there is rejoicing in the presence of angels of God over one sinner who repents. Jesus makes the same point. Now, at this point, I'm guessing the crowd's probably like, all right, Jesus, we get it. You told two stories. You made the same point twice. We totally understand what you're saying. But Jesus says, no, one more. I got another story for you. And Jesus gives us a third parable. And here's what he goes on to say. Jesus says this. There was a man who had, say it with me, two sons. Now, Let's hit pause there for just a second. So I want you to consider this. The parable that Jesus is about to give, the parable that he's about to tell us, is probably the most famous and probably the most beautiful parable, I believe, maybe in all of Scripture that Jesus gives. It's the parable of the prodigal son. And if you've never read it, it's absolutely astounding. It's an amazing parable that Jesus gives. But for our sake today, I'm actually not going to read the whole thing because I understand that in our last session, Pastor Jeff's going to come back around and he's going to address this a little bit. He and I were talking about this. And so I can't wait for you guys in the final session to hear a little bit of the heart of Jesus behind that parable, the last parable that he gives. But here's what I want to invite us to do here in this moment. I actually want to invite you with me just to zoom back for a second. And I want you to consider not each parable individually, but I want you to consider all three of them together for a moment. I want you to zoom out and I want you to think about all three of them. Why is Jesus telling three parables? Is Jesus just making the same point over and over and over again? Is that what Jesus is doing? No, I think Jesus is doing something much more brilliant than that. Rabbis in the first century, they actually had this saying, and their saying was this. They said, parables are like pearls. And what they meant by that was this, is that just like pearls, and a lot of you guys know this, pearls are more beautiful and pearls are more valuable when they're strung together, like in a necklace. And so Rabbi said, parables are more beautiful and they're more valuable when you string them together. What is Jesus doing? Is he just making the same point three times over? No. I think what Jesus is doing is he's stringing together these three parables to make one point. And what is his one point? I think it's brilliant. Think about this with me for a minute. In all three parables, lost sheep, lost coin, lost son. Did you notice that in all three parables that as Jesus tells them, he is decreasing in number? Did you notice that? Let me ask you, how many sheep did the shepherd have? Tell me, remind me. 100. How many coins did the woman have? 10. How many sons? 2. What's Jesus doing? He's decreasing in number. He is narrowing. He is targeting. He's preparing to make his point. But do you notice that while Jesus is decreasing in number, he is also increasing in, do you notice this? Value. It's 100 sheep. It's 10 coins and it's 2 sons. So back in this time, sheep were not all that valuable. I hate to say it, they just weren't all that valuable. Now a coin, on the other hand, especially if it was a denarius and especially if it was part of a wedding dowry, was unbelievably valuable. Oh, but there's nothing more valuable than a son or a daughter. There's nothing more valuable than a child. What is the point that Jesus is making here? Here's what I think Jesus is doing. I think Jesus is reinforcing something that each one of us in this room already know, and that's this. The value of an object determines the intensity of the search. Listen, I think we all know this. The more valuable something is to us, the more intensely and the more adamantly and the more fervently we will try to find it. And when we find it, the more rejoicing that will ensue when we actually find the thing that we've lost. I was thinking about this right here, and I was reminded of, I couldn't help but think of this story. I don't know if you guys heard about this story. It was in the news about this young man named Stephen Thomas. Any of you guys hear about Stephen Thomas before? So I thought this was crazy. So this guy showed up in the news recently, and here's why. So about 10 years ago, Stephen Thomas was hired to make an explainer video that explained cryptocurrencies. You guys know what cryptocurrency is, right? Like Bitcoin and that kind of thing. Okay, so he was hired to make this video to kind of explain how cryptocurrency works, and they paid him in Bitcoin. Now back then, Bitcoin was not worth a whole lot of money. In fact, it pretty much didn't have much value at all. But 10 years later, a lot of you guys know this, Bitcoin is now unbelievably valuable. And so he got paid in Bitcoin back then. Today, his Bitcoin is worth, get this, this is crazy to me, $220 million is what it's worth. $250 million is what his Bitcoin is worth. But here's why he keeps making the news. The reason he keeps making the news is because he forgot his password to access his digital wallet. So what happened was when he got paid, they gave him a password and he allegedly wrote the password down on a scrap piece of notebook paper. Well, he lost the piece of notebook paper. And so now he can't access his digital wallet and get his $220 million. Here's the thing that's so crazy. He has 10 attempts. That's what they gave him. 10 attempts to guess his password. He's used 8. And after two more failed attempts, the password will encrypt itself and he will lose access to that money forever. Now let me ask you this question. If you were Stephen Thomas, how hard are you looking for that piece of paper? Right, man, I would be ripping my house apart. I'd be turning everything upside down. I would be looking at every nook, every cranny. Why? Because here's what we know. I think we all know this. The value of an object determines the intensity of the search. What is Jesus's point as he's telling us this parable? Listen, here's what I think it is. And this is what I think you got to catch. I think Jesus is trying to reveal to us that, listen, it is our heavenly Father who is on an all-out search mission. Listen, I think this is Jesus's point. It's not like the heart of God is not like a shepherd that's looking for a sheep. You are far more valuable than a sheep is to a shepherd. I think the heart of God is not like a woman who is looking for her lost coin. You are far more valuable. You are far more valuable than any sum of money or any item of sentimental value to God. The heart of God is like a father, like a good father, not an imperfect father, a good father who is looking for his lost son and his lost daughter. What is the call of God? Listen, the call of the Father is not like a shepherd calling out to a sheep. It's not like a guy who lost his Bitcoin password. Here's the call of the Father. It's like, Gracie. Gracie, where are you? Do you have any idea how unbelievably valuable you are to your Father? Do you have any idea how valuable every person that you look at, every person in your school, every person in your family, every person that you agree with or don't agree with, do you have any idea how valuable they are to God? I don't think we can understand the call of the Father. I don't think we can understand God's heart apart from this very crucial truth. And I believe that a lot of times the reason we misunderstand God and we misunderstand his heart is because we don't get this. Our heavenly Father is on an all-out search mission that's motivated, look, not by anger, not by disappointment, not by frustration, by love. And every time we turn to him, when we hear that call, we're met with unexpected grace. We're met with joy and rejoicing. I don't think you can understand the Bible without this. The whole Bible, what is that? Man, all the way from the very beginning, the Bible tells us that we were lost in our sin in right on the very same chapter, Genesis chapter 3. What is God doing? He's coming down. Where are you? Where are you? I don't think you can understand Jesus without this. What did Jesus say about himself? Why did Jesus come? Why did Jesus come? The Bible's going to tell us in Luke 19, Jesus says, the Son of Man came to seek and to save that which is lost. Jesus says, you can't understand me without this. The reason that I've come is because our Father is on an all-out search mission that's motivated by love, and he has sent me in love. And listen, if it's true that the value of an object determines the intensity of the search, if that is true, if you want to know how valuable you are, if you want to know how valuable every single person in this room is and every person you've ever set eyes on is, all you need to ask is this question: how intensely did he search? How far did he go? How far did he go? How about this? The Bible tells us that Jesus Christ, that though though he in himself was equal with God, in the very nature God, he did not consider equality with God something to be used to his advantage, but instead he emptied himself and he came to earth. He took on the form of a servant. The Bible tells us that Jesus, how far did he go? How about this? He left heaven and he came to earth. And if that wasn't far enough, the Bible's going to tell us that he went all the way to the cross. He gave his very life for us. How intensely, how far did he go? How about this? Not only did he stop at the cross, but the Bible tells us that he also gave us his Holy Spirit. And if that's not enough, the Bible tells us that he gave us his church. And the reason that you're here is because our Father is on an all-out search that's motivated by love. You're so valuable to your Father. Listen, for some of you, I think you just need to hear me say this, because I honestly believe, I really believe this, that it's incredibly possible, very possible, that some of you are here today simply to hear me tell you this. The reason that God brought you here is because he wants you to know that he's looking for you. He's looking for you. And he's done everything to come to you, and you can turn to him and you can find him. I'm gonna ask the band to come up and settle in. And as the band makes their way up here, here's how I wanna close our time. You guys have a lot more to hear over the next couple of days in these next sessions, but I just wanna close with this. I actually wanna close by giving you a little bit of space. I wanna give you some space to talk to your Father. And so would you do this with me just right now before we worship? Would you just bow your heads and would you just close your eyes? Just do this with me. Bow your heads and close your eyes. I want you to not try as hard as you can. I want you to try to not think about the people around you. Don't think about your friends sitting next to you, or I just want you to search your heart with me right now. And I just want to ask you a few questions, and I just want you to talk to God. For some of you right now, you're in a place where you feel lost. I mean, if you were just being really honest, you feel lost. Maybe you're a person who's lost spiritually. Maybe you're like me when I first came to Momentum. I didn't have a relationship with Jesus. I had never heard that God loved me. I had never heard that he was trying to find me. And maybe that's you. Maybe you feel like even though the people around you have a relationship with God, you don't. Maybe you even wonder why you're here tonight. Your Father's looking for you. He's on an all-out search, and he brought you here because he wants to call you to himself. You can talk to him right now. You can just talk to him. You can just say, I know you're real. I know this is true. I want to respond to your call. For some of you, maybe you feel like you've lost your way. You know, there's a lot of ways to be lost. Maybe if you're being honest, there's some of you right now who maybe you got caught up with a friend group and as a result of that, there's habits in your life right now that you just know are keeping you from a right relationship with God. You just know that that's true and you've kind of lost your way. The Father's crying out to you. He's not disappointed. He wants you to come to him. For some of you, maybe you're lost in a dating relationship. Maybe you're lost in you're in a relationship right now that you know it's not pleasing to God. That's keeping you. It's keeping you from your Father. Right now, some of you are lost. You feel that you've lost your way. Maybe you're lost in your sexuality. Maybe you're lost in your sexual identity. Maybe you're someone right now who's just lost in pornography. It's a porn habit. There's a porn addiction in your life that no one else knows about. And you've tried and you've tried and you've tried and you can't seem to overcome it, but it's just destroying your relationship with God. Some of you are lost in anxiety. Some of you are lost in depression. You know, and like my daughter, some of you might feel full of fear and full of fright and scared that your father is angry with you and upset with you, that you're so far gone and you're so far broken that you're outside of the reach of his love. And I just want to tell you, that's not true. He loves you. You can turn to him now. You can just call out to him and say, God, I want to answer your call. I want to respond to you. And I promise you, when you turn to him, what you're going to find is joy. Father, we just want to come before you and we want to ask you that you would meet us right where we are. Help us to be honest with you. Tear down the walls of the things that are keeping us from our Father who loves us. God, I pray you give the person in this room boldness to turn to you who feels lost and feels shackled by whatever it is that they're stuck in. And would you give them the courage to not just cry out to you, but to talk to someone else too? We need each other, God. We need each other. And so I pray that you'd meet us as we worship and as we sing. God, you have gone to such lengths to find us. There is no distance that you wouldn't span to find us. Thank you. Thank you for your love. Pray it in Jesus' name.